doing all right this evening. I'm going to tell you right now that I'll be looking at the Mbongis tonight and thinking about how you all respond to the next few minutes together. And I'll probably not give the same presentation tomorrow because what I found is that it's very difficult to have a conversation about this topic, even though I was one of the people who helped conceptualize these topics. So Wednesday tomorrow at 12:10 in this room for the other half of freshman seminar, I might do a completely different presentation, or I might be substantially similar, but it won't be the exact same. Because it's a very difficult question. Why must we discuss learning wisdom in the African human experience? This is a picture of a brother named Jacob Carruthers. Dr. Carruthers, one of the great intellectuals of the 20th century, born in Texas. Okay, that's your home. Trained by a number of people, including James Farmer Sr. and some of the great scholars of HBCUs at the turn of the century, who came to the 1930s and 40s and 50s. He went to this little school called Houston Tillerson School. In fact, he was Sam Houston at the time, and the brother who trained him, James Farmer Sr., you've seen the movie The Great Debaters, he is the brother that Forrest Whitaker played in that film, James Farmer's father. This is a brother who, he said, James Farmer and his teachers told him, the reward for good work is more work. And we say that a lot around here. The difference between learning and wisdom is the difference between having information, having access to information, and knowing what to do with that information. So when we talk about learning wisdom, the African world experience, this is actually a picture of him. Some of us in the room, Dr. Beatty, who is here, who you'll be hearing from shortly in a couple of weeks, Dr. Watkins, myself, and some others, attended this ceremony. This is actually a wooden staff with metanetcher, the language of Middle Egyptian, ancient Egyptian language, on the side, and his name, Jedi Shemshu Jehudi. The one who hears is a follower of Jehudi. This is a picture of Jehudi, a statue of Jehudi. Jehudi is the symbol, one half of the Kemetic or Egyptian symbol of intellectual work. He's the male representation. The female representation is, her name is Sheshet. Jehudi was responsible for creating letters, everything that is written through letters. And also, Sheshet is credited with creating numbers, everything that can be counted and measured. Together, these two African symbols are the foundation of what we think about when we think about learning. Dr. Carruthers had something to say about this question of learning wisdom in the African experience. In fact, he said the most serious threat to African dignity is in the domain of intellectual ability. That's in a book he wrote called Metanature, where he talks about, which means divine speech, the idea of deep thinking. He talked about deep thought a lot. The most serious threat to African dignity is in the domain of intellectual ability. Very important to understand. He goes on to say in that same text that African champions must break the chain and link African ideas to European ideas and speak to their ancestors without interpreters. Doesn't mean that African champions, those who are thinking about Africa as a conceptual space in addition to being a physical space, should not engage in conversation with the world. In fact, it means the exact opposite. We must engage in a conversation with every idea in the world and in various ideas of the world, but it begins with having a conversation with ourselves. It's hard to talk to yourself when somebody is in your ear. Some of y'all have tried to have conversations with yourself and you're just trying to think. The Egyptians would say that's the first speech, is the speech you have with yourself. But when you're being constantly interrupted with ideas that won't allow you to think, it becomes very difficult, become disoriented. So he talks about that. So in fact, we've talked a little bit about this question. What is the relationship between learning and wisdom? Well, it gets a little complicated. And what are the contributions of contemporary learning of ideas and practices derived from Africana? By Africana, I simply mean, and what we say here at Howard, Africana means the study of Africa when and wherever you find it. It's not the study of black people or blackness. It's the study of the contributions of those who come out of the African continent in recent memory. The first human contribution out of Africa, of course, is humanity. Everyone in this room comes from Africa. You go back far enough. But I'm talking about those who came most recently and those who occupy the continent most recently. A lot of questions when we start talking about Africana and African stuff, you know, because it's not normal, even in a quote-unquote black space like this. Questions like, you know, why don't we study this black stuff? When can we stop talking about race? What does studying the past have to do with me? Are black people genetically or culturally inferior? That's a little sneaky when people don't really like to say it out of their mouths, but you see it in other ways, like the low expectations we often have of black students and each other. Is there evidence of black greatness, and I was going to put a picture of lost black students here, but I said, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to put insert picture of lost black students. Because I think at some point, everybody in this room has had a picture of a lost student when they looked in the mirror at a moment when they questioned themselves, and we were all being honest with ourselves. So I left that blank. But the act intellectual thrust has been basically for human justice and black humanity. In other words, human justice, not human in terms of just these people or just these people, but everybody, because what has improved African life has improved all life. In fact, we see that in W.E.B. Du Bois. Here is Dr. Du Bois getting an honorary degree from the University of Ghana, where he spent the last 2 years of his life. Dr. Du Bois, you'll hear more about that later on this semester. Dr. Yeboah, who is herself Ghanaian, took students from Howard over there earlier this summer and came back. Those young people's lives were forever transformed. And Du Bois and his wife Shirley Graham are buried there in Accra. They left the United States. In fact, one of the last things he wrote in this country, Dr. Du Bois wrote a message where he said, chin up and fight on, but realize that American Negroes can't win. He wasn't giving up on progress, but what he was saying is, as long as you think in this way, you're gonna constantly hit your head against the wall. And when his friend Kwame Nkrumah invited Dr. Du Bois and his wife to live in Ghana and work on the Encyclopedia Africana, the history of African people throughout time and space, even though he was in his 90s at the time, he said, oh, I got to go. But Dr. Du Bois, before he left, gave a talk at Johnson C. Smith. It is the last chapter in this book. He talked to some social studies teachers. What's the name of that chapter? Flip through there and see. Page 193, 1960. Nice work. I heard it twice in stereo, one female, one male. Nice balance, right off the break. Whither now and why? He writes in there, he sums up what he's been trying to do over the whole arc of his life. This man lived to in his 90s. He started writing as a teenage reporter from Great Barrington, Massachusetts for a black newspaper in New York called The New York Age, published by Timothy Thomas Fortune, one of the great editors of the American journalist tradition. He started writing as a teenager. So this man struggled for 7 decades plus. He said, what I have been fighting for and am still fighting for is the possibility of black folk and their cultural patterns existing in America without discrimination and on terms of equality. Now what we must do is accomplish two things: the utter elimination of color discrimination in American life, haven't got there yet, and the preservation of African history and culture as a valuable contribution to modern civilization as it was to medieval and ancient civilization. We ain't nowhere close to that. You're the first black president. Well, if we did this right, we'd understand that Barack Obama's not the first black leader. But we're not even thinking that way. And you'll read, when we get to this, we're gonna have several sessions where we talk just about the book. It's amazing. Some of y'all have already started reading Beyond the Hampton Idea, but you'll see where he says the laws are gonna change. He left before, we see the Voting Rights Act and the Civil Rights Act. He left before that, but he said, you know, these laws will change. There will be legal equality. Then you gotta answer the real question. What will you be in the society? It's a hell of a question. Morehouse man. Martin Luther King. Always sharp. 1956, 1957. This man's not yet 30 years old. Standing in front of one of the buses that he helped integrate in Montgomery, Alabama. Dr. King, this thing started as a bus boycott led by men like Edie Nixon, women like Rosa Parks, Edie Nixon, a Pullman porter, Edie Nixon, the head of MSCP in Montgomery, Rosa Parks, the head, the youth secretary of the Montgomery branch of the NAACP. Martin King joined in. They said, put King in charge. Why? Because he's a young guy, he's a minister, nobody really knows him, and if he sticks his neck out and gets it chopped off, hell, you know, won't be as bad as the rest of us. King saw that as a moment in time. And as he worked through the night, laboring on what became his talk to those who were protesting. Remind you now, when we go to the New York African Burial Ground, one of the things we do on the buses, so a couple of the buses, I know always we always have on our bus, we put in one of the DVDs that we show on the way up there, is a great screenplay written and produced under the auspices of HBO, entitled Boycott. Some of y'all seen that film? With Jeffrey Wright from Carmen and Dojo playing Martin and Coretta King. And you see him writing. Now, can you imagine a church full of people who think this is about us staying off the bus, getting a little diggity? Dr. King then starts to talk to them and starts saying things like, you know, if I could live any time in history, and I asked God when I'm gonna live, would it be during this period? During this period, he goes through world history, some of world history anyway, and then he says, no, I would say, please let me be alive somewhere near a little bit during the end of the 20th century. He goes on to say, if you will protest courageously and yet with dignity and Christian love when the history books are written in future generations, he's looking at them in 1956 from the future, a future he doesn't make. A future, he's almost like a prophet the night before he's assassinated in Memphis when he says, I may not get there with you. He's looking at them and he says, you know, the historians will have to pause and say there lived a great people, a black people, who injected new meaning and dignity into the veins of civilization. Now these women and men that stayed off these buses for a few days, they hear that and they realize this is bigger than a bus. Here we are celebrating the 50th anniversary of a movement that transformed this country, not because they read the Constitution and were inspired, but because they knew who they were and had a conversation with themselves without interpreters and then Africanized what became the modern United States political economy. So a modern awareness of these thinking traditions is very important. We see some of them, but where did they come from? Did we just learn that once we got here? Because you know, a lot of American history books make you think black people just dropped down in the Western Hemisphere, naked and chained, talking about give us free. It's absurd. But if we don't have anything to replace it, then we just have to listen to that stuff and be mad. It's a recent book on global intellectual history by Samuel Moyne and Andrew Sartori. They have a chapter in there on African intellectual history that's very thin. It's almost like the person didn't study Africa at all. It's like, do you know what you're writing about? It's another recent book, simply called The Book, A Global History. It's a very interesting piece. This came out this summer. So I'm sitting there reading, you know, the first chapter of like 35 chapters in the book. The first chapter I went to, you know, was the chapter on the African book. They're talking about the Judeo-Christian traditions and the Hebrew traditions and how they licked the corner of Ethiopia and then they go into Islam. And I'm like, this is really clueless. This is from Cambridge, Oxford, both have done multi-volume histories of the book. And it's the best you can do for Africa. You need to come to Howard University and take some classes from Dr. Mario Beatty and Metanetcher so you can learn some of the earliest written translations and written traditions of it. You don't count that? No, they got that grouped up in the so-called Middle East. What are y'all doing? Y'all supposed to be respectable scholars. When we think about that, you know, what is the relationship of human memory to identity and recovery? What is the relational dynamic of becoming? In other words, what does memory do for our identity? It's a recent book by David Christian. He's written several recently. This is called The Fleeting World, A Short History of Humanity. And he starts this book by saying, I met with a bunch of social studies teachers and I asked them to name what they could remember of American history. So they started naming George Washington, and they started naming Thomas Jefferson and the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence coming forward. They talk about, people thought they were real cute. So they talked about the Northwest Ordinance in 1789, and they started talking about the compromises of 1820 and 1850 and so forth and coming forth. And then maybe they linger on Dred Scott if they want to throw some Negroes in. Then they get to the Civil War, after Civil War, Reconstruction, get past Reconstruction, come through the Gilded Age, make a left turn at the turn of the century around the notion that was sparingly America's empire of color with the Philippines, Puerto Rico, and all that kind of thing. So these people think they're doing real good. And they get up into the 20th century heavy, right? The stock market crash, 1929, the Gilded Age comes to a close, then World War I, World War II, then okay, Vietnam, Cold War, blah, 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 come up to the present, it's nice. What about anything else, okay? They say, well, let's do some Western civilization. Okay, Greece, Rome, y'all know how it works, Enlightenment, Renaissance, blah, 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 the names you all know, Pizarro, Cortez, Columbus, all the stuff you have to study on your knees, this kind of thing going forward, blah, 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 you know, Charlemagne, Holy Roman Empire, blah, blah, Napoleon, y'all know how this works. Okay, what about world history? Okay, well, there was some Chinese somewhere. India, yeah. And there were people here too. I mean, you know, savage. Can I say savage? Redskin? No, I can't say redskin. Indigenous, First Nations. That's what they can't. They don't say nothing. What happened to the rest of the world? African history? Tribes. Slavery. Slavery. And you know, black people sold each other into slavery. Talking like they actually know something about this. Can I say Harriet Tubman? Barack Obama! His father was from Kenya. They don't know nothing! You almost have to turn the world right side up. That's Africa. This is the cover of a book that our colleagues in the Association for the Study of Classical African Civilizations did called the Preliminary Challenge. This is the African World History Project. Dr. Beatty, myself, Dr. Myers, Dr. Yabwa, a number of us, Dr. Watkins, work on the African World History Project. That actually would be okay if the world was the globe and not a map, and it was 3D, because Africa is like two, like a T. Du Bois writes this in a book called The Negro, 1915. He says, Africa's like a T. The top part, and then the long stem. And if it was 3D, it would rise up like a table and be like two saucers falling off because the rivers run off into the sea. And the Nile River actually runs that way. A map isn't a globe. A map is a document people write to create cultural geography. Who said Africa looked the other way? Who drew that map? But then becomes a clash of knowledges, the hierarchy of thinking and people. There's a recent book, well, not recent now, about 10 years ago, called Academic Charisma and the Origins of the Research University by William Clark. All the things we do, the lectures, the exams, all this thing, all this stuff comes out of medieval Europe, right? But what you see is that those same universities, when they are founded in the United States, Princeton, Harvard, Columbia, which was the King's College, the oldest universities, were universities that were built, many of them, off the labor of enslaved Africans. The money that was used to endow them and to found them was based on slave labor, and the people who went to those schools, many of them brought enslaved Africans with them. This is in Craig Stephen Wilder's new book, Ebony and Ivy, Race, Slavery, and the Troubled Histories of America's Universities. But what does Howard do in every university in this country? Instead of thinking, can we reimagine the university to be very different? And Du Bois writes about this. You're going to read a whole chapter in here, Field and Function of the Negro College. You're going to read a whole chapter on the future of the Negro State University. You're going to read a whole chapter where he says, what does it mean to be a black university in America? We know what a French university does, an English university does. They ground in a different culture. Well, what does that mean for black? Well, do we change that? No, we haven't changed that. What do? We copy. We don't copy it. The people transform from the inside. The structure hasn't transformed, but the people do try to transform. So, universities have searches for truth, training new generations, and producing new knowledge. So we move forward then. How do we reframe our view in 40 minutes? Not even 40 minutes now, 30 minutes. And Ms. Banks has reminded us in Crampton, we gotta be out of here by 7 o'clock because there's a lot going on. So we gotta move, right? 29 minutes. We gotta ask different questions. Begin to find different answers. We tried that in Philadelphia with the Scooters in Philadelphia. We put a whole curriculum where you ask different questions. No time to talk about that now. We got classes on campus where you can take that. The Freedom Schools exercise, we tried that in Freedom Schools in Philadelphia and beyond. Dr. Yabwa helped run that program for years. We tried to deal with that. Ms. Heath, are you a graduate? One of your graduate TAs, product of that program. Helped her get several degrees from Penn State and come here and work on a PhD. We reframe how we ask different questions, right? The Howard Africana Studies experience. That's what we're trying to do in Africana Studies, but not just Africana Studies, in English, in history, in philosophy, across the range. We're trying to do that at Howard. Freshman seminar, that's the product, the embalming. That's what we're working on. Is African progress fantasy? Any of y'all read comic books? Okay, y'all know then tomorrow's a sacred day, comic book day. Go get my comic books every Wednesday. I've been reading them since I was 9 years old. One title that comes in and out, sometimes he has a book, sometimes he doesn't. Sometimes he's in other people's books like The Avengers and them, sometimes he doesn't. I'm scared to death because they said they're going to make a movie about him, and I'm mad because Wesley Snipes is too old to play him, and maybe Jijima Hansu could play him, but it's the Black Panther from Wakanda, right? This is a panel from when Reginald Hudlin was writing the book. Wakanda is an African nation, a pretend African nation where the question is asked, what would African nations look like if there was ever never any slavery or colonialism? So they're way developed scientifically, but culturally they're still African. So here he is talking to these European diplomats. So the guy says, Your Majesty, we'll pay you whatever price you set for your goods. My man says, they are not for sale. He says, until the spiritual advancement of the West catches up to their technological prowess, it would be irresponsible to share our scientific discoveries with you. My man upset. What? Are you calling everyone here irresponsible children? The Panther says, all cool. No. He says, more like sullen teenagers who feel more mature than their behavior warrants. The fact that every conversation here is framed in terms of profit and power says it all. That's culture. STEM? What is the STEM for? You see what he said in the Hampton idea. It's one thing to have skills, but education, higher education, is about power. What do you do with the skills? So So you know we love the fantasy. This is a book from years ago. This is back in the late 70s. The Panther fighting the Klan. It's like, you gotta love that, right? The Black Panther, at last, T'Challa battles the Klan. Come on, let's just take this dude now. I did hear this recent tune by G-Unit about what happened in Ferguson. Similar kind of sentiment. But does it have to be fantasy? Well, African contributions include possibilities. There's Dr. Williams. Here goes a Blackburn full. You can't, I just took this picture of the corner. It's all around here. The Imbadagesha is sitting next to us. This is Wole Soyinka, the Nobel laureate from Nigeria, who visited us last year because we read his book of Africa. And that night, he started talking to us about the ideas that he had in his book of Africa as it relates to the reality of what Africa has to give to the world. And he says, you know, there also exist dynamic possessions, ways of perceiving, responding, adapting, or simply doing that vary from people to people, including structures of human relationships. These all constitute potential commodities of exchange, not as negotiable as timber, petroleum, or uranium, perhaps, but nevertheless recognizable as defining the human worth of any people and could actually contribute to the resolution of the existential dilemma of distant communities, or indeed to global survival, if only they were known about or permitted their proper valuation. People think the only thing Africa has to give is stuff, oil, timber, manganese, rubber, copper. And in terms of people, they think the only thing that Africa has to give is a lot of energy and like people who like to dance and it's very exotic and interesting. Funny enough, it's kind of like the same way people think about Africans in this country. Or the Caribbean or Latin America. What are black people good for? Singing and dancing and entertaining and telling jokes. And what about running institutions? What Soyinka is saying that people have dynamic possessions. That's what culture is a dynamic possession. He said you may decide that it is in fact they canceled an opera over a depiction of Muhammad. He writes about it in the book. He says that the Muslims got mad because they didn't like, they had all these different religious traditions depicted, but Muhammad, they didn't like the way Muhammad was portrayed. So Yenke says in the book, he says, you know, the funny thing about me, I'm looking at this saying, my problem is not the portrayal of Muhammad. My problem is you ain't dealing with any African traditions. No Vodun, no Santeria, no Ifa from Yoruba, none of the Igbo traditions, none of the traditions of Southern Africa, the Nguni language speakers, the Zulu, the Sana, the Soto, nothing from East Africa. But you act like anything African people were thinking about is superstition. And yet, on the first Sunday of the month, people will come into the Christian tradition and put a wafer and some grape juice in their mouth and say, take, eat, this is my body. Ain't nothing wrong with that, but ain't nothing wrong with the other traditions either if you're thinking about them as approaches to knowledge, but Africa is excluded. Anybody been to Brazil? Y'all been to Salvador? If you've been to Salvador, Bahia, very good. Then you know that these are statues of Orisha. These are statues of African women, some of the spiritual symbols of Africa that were preserved in Brazil. And then you go through downtown Salvador, I took that picture, you can see off of a brochure I had, because I've been there and I got pictures of those pieces. And it's amazing. Their Africa is out in full view. Our Africa is hidden in plain sight. Y'all go down to the National Portrait Gallery sometime and see the little statue model of the Statue of Liberty. Because when the French gave it to the United States, they wanted to symbolize, among other things, the end of enslavement in this country. And the original statue has ankles with chains around them that have been broken. The United States said, okay, we can take the statue, we gotta get rid of the chains. You can go see the original model down there. We don't need any reminders. So how does the diaspora contribute? All the people in the world walked out of Africa at some point, populated the world. These are the more recent arrows, the last several hundred years, for the people who came out of Africa and where they went. All through here, but not just through there, all the way up to the Saudi Peninsula, all the East Africa, Swahili coast into this region, and then into Europe as well. So enslavement wasn't just about the United States of America. And this guy right here, this brother right here, Robert Ferris Thompson, has written a lot about that. He's at Yale University. European American, has immersed himself in Africa study over the last 50 years. And one of his most recent books, The Aesthetic of the Cool, Afro-Atlantic Art and Music. He's writing about the fact that this African contribution pulsates throughout the African world. I love the way David Jork, the poet from Martinique, said it. Africa, my Africa, though I've never seen you, my face is full of your blood. You want to hear Africa, just go right down there across from the CVS and listen to them Negroes playing go-go out that storefront. You don't have to go on a plane, train to get away. No, just go there. But you know what? His teacher was a brother named Kimwandinde Fukia. This is also the brother who talks about the Mbongi. It's a book he wrote on the subject. Fukia taught Ferris Thompson, who writes about it, but this is the master. He's from West Central Africa. Seeing oneself in time and space is the beginning of wisdom. It's a picture that I took of one of the Howard students looking at that's from Abu Simbel, looking at Ramesses II. That's the dude that Michael Jackson and model a little bit of Eddie Murphy on in Remember the Time video. You know, it's like Michael Jackson did more for people thinking about Africans being in the Nile Valley than thousands of books. It's funny how when that video come on, they get ready to do that dance number, everybody just get quiet. That's the genius of Michael Jackson. It's not American genius, that's African genius, born in America. That's African genius. His mother's from Alabama, not too far from where my mother was born. His whole family on his mother's side were singers. His father, Joe, and them came out of Arkansas. They made them babies in Gary, Indiana, and the rest of the world will never be the same. That's Africa contributing. And at night, at James Brown's funeral, Michael Jackson stood up there and said, night, my mother would wake me up and break me and sit me in front of the TV and say, watch him. That's genealogy. That's what it looks like in ways we can recognize. But it's not just singing and dancing. Everybody repeat after me. Boko.
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 One more time. Boko.
Boko.
Boko means to break or to cut, as in the deciding of solutions or problems. These are terms associated with Mbongi. This is what Fukuyama is writing about. He says the first of the Boko, you get together to break down a problem. That's what we're going to do in the sessions when we just talk about the book. Boko, we're going to break the problem down. Any y'all ever been in those deep sessions, two or three of y'all, or five or ten of y'all trying to figure out a problem, and just get quiet? That's an Mbongi. It's pulsating. Let's do the second of four. Let's do it. Three times. One time. Yimba. Our friend Georgia Dunstan, she and her friend Fatima Jackson worked on the Human Genome Project, the geneticists. They're both here on Howard's faculty. You'll hear from Fatima later this semester. Georgia started studying quantum physics a few years ago with James Lindsay, one of Dean Donaldson's colleagues. Physics, mathematics, talk about quantum theory. The whole idea that everything has a vibration. When you say something collectively, it vibrates. You ever had friends or enemies or whatever that come into a room, make everybody feel better, or somebody come in the room, bring everybody's spirit down? That the Dustin says, because their energy is funky, but their energy is good. James Brown come in, you can't be mad at a James Brown song. I want to get up and do my thing. People say, okay, I can't stop. Which is why that garbage movie, Get On Up. Yes, I said garbage. We can talk about it after. The one thing that wasn't garbage about it was the music, because you can't mess James Brown up. My man Chadwick Boseman did a good job pretending to be James Brown when he was dancing and singing, but when he was talking, just YouTube James Brown and watch interviews with James Brown and see how jacked up that movie was. Break the chain and speak to your ancestors without interpreters. I just ask you to do that and see if you don't think what I'm thinking. Yemba means to create a shelter in order to cover and protect. That's what this Howard University space is. We're protected here to have our conversations, to build our embodies. Third and four. Let's do it together. Luzanga.
Luzanga.
Luzanga. In many libation traditions throughout Africa, the powerful move in the sound is down, not up. Somebody do a great dunk, it's like, ah! It's like, ooh. You go down, you connect to the elemental force of the grounding. You'll see ministers, when somebody really preaching, they pull that white handkerchief out. That's not England, that's not France, that's not Germany, that's not Spain, that's not the monastic traditions of medieval Europe, that's not Henry VIII trying to get a divorce and creating the Church of England and the Anglican tradition, that's Africa. You put it on the ground. That's bad, ooh. Run DMC, not bad meaning bad, but bad meaning good. To translate that, it's not a look of pain, it's a look of, that's funky. The word funky, Robert Ferris Thompson through Fukuyama say that word doesn't have an etymology that comes out of European languages. In fact, what Fukuyama says is it probably comes out of Kikongo, Lufuki, which means literally to be up under somebody so deeply you can just smell their essence. Not literally, sometimes literally. If any of y'all have been in a space where clearly the whole energy changed and you didn't know how much it changed till you stepped out, You at the party, you come out, whoo. What that is in there, that's a whole nother thing. That's an mbangi. Y'all done made some energy there. You done mixed. Luzanga literally means to mix, to put together, to assemble. Finally, Kyoto. 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 And y'all ever had Vicks Vapor Rub rubbed on your chest about somebody home? Yes. That Vicks Vapor Rub. To inhale, to intake a healing property or cure. In other words, it isn't just the literal cure, it opens you up. Something you hear, something you read, something. Some of y'all have already started with this book. You read a line and had to put the book down. That's when you read. My man got some turns of phrases in here that you just stop everybody in their tracks. You're like, oh, man. It's a bad boy. In those traditions, start in classical Africa. We've been there. Those walls, great avenue of the sphinxes, linking Opet, Asit, and southern Opet, what they call Luxor and Karnak in Nile Valley. The books of Timbuktu in West Africa, some of them as old as 600 years. The traditions, I took that picture from a balcony. Dr. Williams, myself, Dr. Myers, Dr. Beatty, we've been there, Dr. Watkins, we'd be over there, go to the Nile Valley, we go on Elephantine Island, these are the Nubian girls. Children. In the middle of that jump rope right there, this young lady is from Howard. This young lady right here is from Miles College in Alabama. And the young lady right here holding her hand is some of the Nubian girls. Because when they get off the boat, them young girls got the jump rope in the hand. Let's see what y'all got. So they get in the circle and be like, y'all gonna play with us. We gonna find out if we sisters or not. You ain't got time to practice. Culture is what you do when you don't think too hard about what you're doing. You do what you learn through your life. It's very important to understand you got family all over the world. Dilated people say, I got worldwide family all over the earth and I care about them all for whatever it's worth. Very important to understand that, because you then see, here is a circle of brothers burning their beers at Drew Hall like we did Sunday night. Getting a big circle. Everybody out. Write down what scares you the most. Burn it up. Every Sunday, the Sunday before school starts. Very important to do that. But you see the mbangis. Here's an mbangi from Reconstruction United States. Talk about school crowding. It's one dude who knows how to read and all the black people who came out of slavery, their children, they sent them up there and said, y'all need to learn how to read because this is what's going to get us free. Education is a serious thing for these people. So serious that when you see it in the eyes of somebody, this was on the cover of the New York Times a couple of years ago. This is in South Africa. Who do you think wants to let down anybody in that mbangi on what the right answer is? In fact, they're looking at her. Ain't nobody going to say, look, she's looking like you better not get this wrong. Hand on it. Please. You ever been to South Africa, you see, some of y'all, I'm not saying South Africa, some of y'all been in those classrooms where seem like you're very life dependent on getting the right answer. But not just for yourself, it was for your team. We're gonna talk about that when we get to the group projects. And there are those who have been writing about this, men like Diabello Bengu. This is one of the scholars who trained us, he's in the Congo. He wrote a book called African Philosophy in the Period of the Pharaohs, about the Africans who wrote the ancient Egyptian language and dealt with that question. There are books like Inscribing Meaning, Writing and Graphic Systems in African Art. You should go down to the African Art Museum. The woman who curated this Inscribing Meaning display, this exhibit, rather, works at the African Museum. She loves to see when y'all come down and took a whole bunch of students down there a couple of years ago. It was crazy because they had some Egyptian stuff up front and some of these students had taken Dr. Beatty's class already. So when she said, and this is, and I said, no, excuse me, translate that. She was like, oh. She has a PhD in African art history, but she can't read the glyphs. And so she was like, you know, all I can do is rely on what they tell me. Child said, yeah, African champions must break the chains that link African ideas to European ideas and speak to their ancestors without interpreters. Let me read the next line. Now you wrote that 4,000 years ago, but you're talking to me now. I can listen and talk back. That's what scholarship is for. And you don't have to leave this campus to do the very same thing. That's why we work here, so you achieve another level. Count Like an Egyptian, this just came out, Hands-On Introduction to Ancient Mathematics. It's like a cartoon cover in some ways, but when you read it, you see how the Egyptians thought about math, because math is a culture element. One of the most brilliant people I know on that subject is James Donaldson, former dean of this college. Yeah, some of y'all like that. Y'all just like doing math. Some of y'all say you're not good at math. No. Somebody, you had a bad teacher at some point. That's all that is. That ain't got nothing to do with your ability. Because if you can dance, you can do math. If you can count, you can do math. If you worry about somebody shorting you out some money and you're watching their hand move back and forth, you can do math. Because math is just about relationships. But you need an expert. You need somebody to help you bubble that up out of your talent. And that's what Du Bois is writing about. This between education and training. In the Hampton idea. He ain't mad at Hampton. He's just saying, y'all got to contemporize. In fact, what did he say? I gave this talk, they didn't invite me back for 30 years. I'll come back to that in a second. It's 6:49. What does learning African style look like? This is some Africans. This is one time we were in Kemet. We were in the Nile Valley. Y'all see us there, chilling. With Dr. Beatty back there, chilling. He got sunglasses on. Y'all cool. This is Ramesses II from a statue at Abu Simbel. But you know, there's a new movie coming out, because guess what? These narratives always want to make something not true. And I'm the first one to say, go enjoy the movies, everybody enjoy their life, it's very nice. But if you don't know any better, you might think something like this is actually true. There's Batman, Christian Bale. Playing Moses and his brother, the age of Ramesses, Exodus, gods and kings. Nobody won't see that. I'll watch it. The bootleg. Because I'm not about. I know that's fine. I didn't say I would purchase the bootleg. I was telling you I got a law degree. You gotta be real careful with language. But my point is, this is a distortion. Here's Ramesses. That's actually his sapu, his mummy. That's him on the rock. This is another brother that Sheikh Adejoa points out, got the kind of blue crown hairstyle. This man's nose is like a beak because the flesh has collapsed. It's fleshed out. His nose is probably wider than this man's nose. His lips, you see the outline of the lips. The lips have collapsed. This man ruled 4,000 years ago almost. Lips come out like that probably. His hair is straight in part. You are in the hottest part of Africa, underground. And they bombarded him with x-rays. But that's not important. What's important is that you can, if you have an idea in your head and you have some knowledge, you can have a great time with it and educate people, and they don't even know they're being educated, even if it's not completely historically accurate. It's much closer than stuff like this. In fact, the people who you put together look like the people who built those pyramids. You might even act like Michael Jackson. I ain't mad at this brother for that. Because guess what? That's a Somali right there. If you want to look in the face of who was ruling Egypt, you're looking at it. And of course, if you move that thing, Eddie Murphy don't look that different from Ramesses. But the whole point is, that's just one way of thinking about it, right? So at this stage in human history, where we at right now, 2014, connectivity enables higher collective thinking. There's a new book called The Fourth Revolution that talks about this idea that there's, once we get connected to everything, the information revolution, the fourth revolution, is going to lead to a space where we can either be very much closer together, an Mbangi, or we can be very individualized, the anti-Mbangi. That ain't gonna help nobody. Culture matters. The hive mind has been talked about in some of these readings. Pieces like this book, The Anti-Education Era by James Paul McGee, who's out at Stanford. His whole argument is, connectivity will enable us to think together. You can have a great Mbangi if we're all contributing to these same things. Technology can be used that way. But like that comic book with T'Challa, if you don't have a culture, you can also use it to blow up the damn world. Technology is one thing. Thinking is another. That's why COAS is the College of Arts and Sciences. These things must be together. And so, culture matters. The purpose and role of human life means marshaling both group thinking and individual, small group insight and innovation. Relevance or irrelevance is a choice. Is it the happy paradigm? I'm not mad. You think happy paradigm is a situation where you're thinking about whether or not you want to be happy and, just very nice because I'm happy. Oh. Yeah. Or you could be like Du Bois. That's Du Bois with a cousin of his and his grandson, Arthur McFarlane. I know Arthur. Josh and I saw him, they dedicated a bust to his grandfather down at Atlanta University. They have a big bust of Du Bois that they unveiled on his birthday last year. We went down for it. He's an older man now. This is him when he's a little boy. Du Bois gave a talk with his grandson there. He said, I'm giving this talk to my grandson. I won't be around when he becomes a man, but I'm telling you now everything I've done is for you. He wrote this book for y'all. crazy. He's been gone 50-some years. He wrote this book for y'all and for us. So we think about, boys, in African progress. What is the possibility of African progress? Well, what do we know about this young cat right here? As Du Bois is a young man, around the time he gave a talk called The Conservation of Races. Right around the time that Alexander Cromwell, one of his mentors, started the American Negro Academy and met right here in Washington, D.C. Du Bois was born in 1868 in Great Barrington, Massachusetts. Got his bachelor's degree from Fisk HBCU. Got his MA and his PhD from Harvard. 1897, he gave that talk. In that talk, he says, every group of human beings have a special thing to give to everybody else, not to keep to themselves. From 1897 to 1910, he taught at Atlanta University. He was there again from 1934 to 1944. Why? Because in 1910, the first Pan-African Conference, headed by a dude from Trinidad and Tobago named Henry Sylvester Williams. 1905, he co-founded the Niagara Movement. These were black folks who decided that it was going to be something serious. They had to be done about the race question. They met at Niagara Falls in north of New York. And then they had a race riot in Springfield, Illinois in 1908. And white folks decided white folks who needed to say that things need to change. They were going to start a group called the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. They asked Du Bois and his friends in Niagara to join. So they did. And Du Bois co-founded the magazine of the NAACP, the Crisis Magazine, 1910. Then they put him out in 1934 because they say he was talking too strong about black people should own their own institutions. So they put him out. He went back to Atlanta University, worked for 10 years, then he went back to the Mississippi, then they put him out again. Du Bois, I don't give a damn. But they made this friend, John Hope, try to fire him. Then John Hope, who was the president then of Atlanta University, died. And Du Bois got put out in 1944. That man was near 80 years old and lost his job because people couldn't deal with what he was putting down. He co-convened the Pan-African Congresses of 1919, 21, 23, 27, 1945. The young Africans came in Manchester, England. Some of them were like Kwame Nkrumah, the first prime minister of Ghana, Jomo Kenyatta, the first prime minister of Kenya. He moved to Ghana to work on the Encyclopedia Africana, and he passed away in 1963. Main themes. What does Du Bois call the true founding stone of all education? Does anybody remember? That's in the introduction. Not the kindergarten, but that's right, the college, higher education. That's right, where y'all at? He said, it's the most important thing. The great lack. What's the great lack? He says, like, go ahead.
Energy.
Wow. And the great fear is what? They'll get it. Can you imagine that? That was the great fear in Ferguson. These Negroes, their energy. Oh my God, they're going to get some energy. Send the police. Two types of training. He talks about higher education gives you power, technical education gives you work skills. There's a new book called The Teacher Wars, A History of America's Most Embattled Profession. Diana Goldstein, I heard on the radio today, she was saying, much of what we talk about in education reform in America, I was surprised in my research to find out how much of it comes from African-American ideas on education. I thought to myself, I'm not. Glad you found out. Now go tell the rest of the country. Because at Howard, we're not going to get confused. 656, about to close this down. 10 addresses, 6 HBCUs. That's what this book does. Du Bois on Africans. I wonder, is this belief or fact? The great lack of the Negro race and of nearly all the darker races today, energy. He says this. How do y'all feel about this? We're going to talk about this maybe more in a session we talk about the book. Nor is this racial indolence or ease of life a fault or badge of inferior gifts or development. It simply represents a defense of tropical races against the tropical sun. No hurried, worried race could ever have risen out of the blazing suns of Africa. Rather, conditions of living there demand that languid dalliance with nature and her wants, which we crudely and harshly call the laziness of the tropics.